Science. This is Professor Tim Wegner. He's working on his PhD up at Michigan State University. So he's doing that full-time at the same time that he's teaching full-time for us. I don't know how he does it, and he's got two children that are small. That's
yes.
Amazing. Wow. He gets the gold star on the forehead. Thank you. Great. So let's give Professor Wegner our attention.
As Dr. Baldwin said, I am attending grad school right now. My suggestion for all of you, if you're thinking about going to grad school, don't get married and get a full-time job first. Go to grad school first and then get married and get a job. Your life will be so much better. Because like you guys, I have lots of sleepless nights where I'm up until 3 a.m. trying to get papers done for grad school, while at the same time trying to get lesson plans done for Spring Arbor. And yeah, go to grad school first. If you're even remotely thinking about it, go to grad school first. The program that I'm in right now is at Michigan State is called Prime because they're mathematicians and they think they're clever.
Which
stands for the Program in Math Education. And I don't know why they couldn't come up with an R word, but they didn't. Instead, they just, like, program rooted in math education. I don't know. There could have been some R word, I would imagine, that could have gone there. The interesting thing about the program that I'm in is that it's not just a math program, which means I don't just take math classes all day long. It's not just an education program, so I don't just take education classes all day long, but it's co-sponsored by the math department and the education department. And so I look at how do students learn mathematics? How do teachers teach mathematics? How do textbooks write mathematics? How do people talk about mathematics? What are the policy issues related to mathematics? What are the equity issues related to mathematics? So more of that type of stuff rather than all the intricacies of calculus or differential equations or anything like that. For those who aren't familiar with PhD requirements or how a PhD works, some of the general things you have to do for a PhD. Obviously, there's a bunch of coursework. Take a bunch of classes. Thankfully, I'm almost done with that. I have one more course to take for my PhD. Hopefully, I can get that done this summer, and then I'm done with courses forever, and it's going to be so wonderful. The other part of a PhD program is something called comprehensive exams, which I just took like 3 weeks ago. It's a big test that basically covers everything you've ever learned since you were able to walk. And those are super stressful, and I turn them in, but I don't have my results yet. But hopefully I'm done with those, assuming I pass. And then the last two things I have to finish up, one of them I finished up in winter, is something called a practicum. I'm going to come back to that in a second. But then the big thing that most people are familiar with is this thing called a dissertation, where you set up a big study, an experiment of some sort. You know, in our case, in math education, a lot of times it's sticking kids in a classroom, videotaping them, watching how they interact with each other and with the mathematics. But you end up with this big 300-page paper. You get to publish shorter papers in journals, and that's basically the do or die. Do you get your degree or do you not get your degree? But before my program lets me do that, they make me do a miniature version that they call a practicum. So that way, as I'm learning how to do research, if I screw stuff up, it's not the end of the world. So it's kind of just a practice one before I get to the dissertation. And the practicum work is what I'm going to talk about today. And so I finished that up in December. It was a 2-year project looking at students. The actual name of the practicum is Strategies Employed by College Students or College Mathematics Students When Using Dynamic Geometry Environments. I'm assuming we know what college mathematics students are. I'm going to go out on a limb and assume probably we don't know what dynamic geometry environments are, since I don't see a lot of math majors in here. I see a lot of chemistry and biology majors in here. So I'm going to exit out of my PowerPoint for a moment to show you what a dynamic geometry environment is. Some of you, depending upon what high school you went to, may have used these in your high school geometry class. But a dynamic geometry environment allows you to do straight edge and compass constructions on a computer. I don't know if any of you guys in your high school class got to use the little compasses, draw circles, draw straight edges. Hopefully some of you at least got to do it by hand. Anybody actually use software with it? Yes? Do you remember what the name of the software was?
No.
Was it Sketchpad? Does that sound familiar? No?
It had Pad in it.
It had Pad in it? Okay. I'm going to guess it's Sketchpad. It's the most popular one in schools. It lets you draw things on the screen. In this case, a circle. But then the nice thing about it that makes it so great is that after you draw it, you can change the shape of it. You know, if back in the 80s, when some of the other professors in this room were in school, actually 70s, I don't know when they were in school. They got to do things by hand, and once you draw the picture by hand, it's stuck. You can't change it. You have to draw a new picture. We, thankfully, nowadays, get to change things. And so it allows us to do construction. So I'm going to start with the basic construction. Let's say we wanted to construct an equilateral triangle. Anybody know what an equilateral triangle is? All three sides the same. It's literally equilateral, same sides. So if we wanted to do that, let's say we want this dot to this dot as our side length. We could then move that over there. We could put a dot at the top. Oops. And we get what hopefully is an equilateral triangle. Now, how do we know for sure that's an equilateral triangle? Well, we could measure the sides. One nice thing about the software, as compared to doing it by hand, is there's a nice little measurement tool that says measure the distance. And that's really hard to see, but it says 2.19. We could measure the other distance. And it's going to say something similar, hopefully the exact same thing, 2.19. And we could measure the bottom. And again, it'll say 2.19. Equilateral triangle. And the nice thing is, even if we change it, so the sides may change, but they're still the same. It's still an equilateral triangle. We've successfully constructed an equilateral triangle. So that's the software that I was looking at for my project, is how are students actually interacting with that software? And so the purpose of the study that I undertook was to understand how students are interacting with that software. I mean, because in the general scheme of math education, the software is not that old. I mean, it's 20 years old, but students have been in classes a lot longer than 20 years. And so there's still lots of research to be done on how students are using the software. And so the two questions I had going forward with my project were, what type of reasoning strategies, so what specifically, how are they thinking in their brain as they're using dynamic geometry environments to develop geometric proofs? So you may have done some proofs when you took a high school course. A lot of times you did two column proofs where you did idea and then explanation, and you had to give a reason for it, and then you stated something, gave an explanation, stated something, gave an explanation. Same idea. Most college students write them out in paragraphs rather than two column proofs, but the same idea. And then more interesting to me is the second bullet point that says, do the reasoning strategies vary when we explore different types of geometric systems? And I list three of them there: Euclidean, hyperbolic, and elliptic. So what do I mean by different geometric systems? The first one, Euclidean, that's the one that we all know and love. It's the one that we learned in high school. It's the one that we learned in elementary school. A lot of people just call it high school geometry, and that's what we were doing. If I exit out of that, that's what this was. High school geometry. You could probably have done that in your high school geometry course at some point. You may not remember it, because I know some of you like to block that from your memory, but at some point you probably did that exact same thing. So that's what we mean by Euclidean geometry. Now, why do we call it Euclidean geometry? And here I'm going to do a little bit of math history with you. So, call high school geometry, but we attribute it to a guy named Euclid. He's a Greek geometer dating back to about 300 years before Christ. And he wrote a book called The Elements. Not the chemistry elements. No, I'm sorry. There's no chemistry at all in the book. What The Elements are, is it's the first book that laid out high school geometry, or what we call high school geometry, in an orderly fashion. Euclid started with a basic set of assumptions, something that he thought everybody could agree on. So here's what we're going to assume. And from there, he worked up to simpler results and then more complicated results. And he was the first one to do that. So he didn't necessarily come up with all of the mathematics, but he arranged it in a nice logical order. Interesting factoid about that book is that it's estimated, no one knows for sure, but it's estimated, assumed to be second only to the Bible in the number of editions that have actually been published. And currently there's over 1,000 different editions of that book that have been published over the years, in addition to different translations. You know, every language you can think of, somebody's translated it into, and periodically people retranslate it, thinking their translation's better than the old translations. Now, to put that in perspective, there's over 1,000 editions of that have been published. Harry Potter, anybody want to take a guess how many editions of Harry Potter exist?
I'm too young.
You're too young. Under 500. I found a site that had 467 listed. I don't know how accurate it is, but under 500. And so the Elements has that beat by at least twice, so that made me happy. The Bible, I have no idea actually how many editions of the Bible there are, but when you consider all the different translations, I mean, it's, yeah, way more than 1,000, I'm guessing. So, very popular book. Up until the 19th century, any educated person had read that book. You know, if you look at our founding fathers, they read that book. If you look at Abraham Lincoln, he read that book. Everybody had read The Elements. I mean, it was just standard college curricula. Unfortunately, we've moved away from that. It makes me sad, makes my heart break a little bit. But such is life. Now, I mentioned he started with some basic assumptions. Well, what are those basic assumptions he started with? He had five. The first basic assumption he started with that said, if you have two points, you can connect them with a straight line. So to draw a straight line from any point to any other point. So he's not saying a whole lot there. Literally, oh, I don't have a marker, do I? I have chalk, though. All he's saying is, if you have two dots, you can draw a line across them. Not saying a lot. I think we can all agree that if you have two dots, you can draw a straight line across them. His second assumption was, you can take that straight line, and you can make it go forever in either direction. So assuming you have a big enough chalkboard, you can keep going all the way to the left, and you can go all the way to the right as far as you want, infinitely, both directions. Again, nothing crazy going on there. His third assumption was that it's possible to draw a circle. So if you give a center of a point, and you know what the radius is, it's possible to draw a circle. And typically, the way that we do that is with a tool called a compass. Let's just draw those circles. Whereas with this one, of course, it'd be a straight edge. So two tool, compass, straight edge. Anyway, I don't think anybody's going to disagree that we can draw a circle. They're not hard to draw. The other assumption he made, all right angles are equal to each other. You know, nothing crazy going on there. If you have a right angle, and you have another right angle, which, by the way, are 90 degrees, for those who may have forgotten, they're the same, regardless of where you draw them. Nothing crazy going on. Until you get to the fifth one. And then all of a sudden, life gets interesting. That, if a straight line falling on two straight lines makes the interior angles on the same side less than two right angles, the two straight lines, if produced indefinitely, meet on that side on which are the angles less than two right angles.
Whoa.
That one's a bit more complicated. Now, an easier way to say essentially the same thing. A guy named Playfair, when did Playfair live? I want to say 1700s, don't quote me on that. Rewrote it this way, and here's the way that most high school textbooks have it. Given a line and a point not on that line, so given a line and a point not on that line, exactly one line parallel to the given line can be drawn through the point. So if we want to draw a parallel line here, there's only one parallel line we can draw. Any other line you draw, assuming that went through the point, is eventually going to cross. There's only one parallel. Now, that assumption is a lot more complicated than the first four assumptions. You know, especially the way that Euclid originally wrote it. That's just super confusing sounding. Playfair at least wrote it a little simpler, but it's still a lot more complicated than those first four bullet points. And so since he wrote his book, mathematicians have tried to figure out, can they use the first four assumptions to prove the fifth assumption? Should it not be an assumption? Because as mathematicians, we like to assume as little as possible. And so is it possible to use the first four to get to the fifth one? Eventually, after struggling for literally 2,000 years to try to prove it, they asked themselves, what would happen if it wasn't true? I mean, does the world break if it's not true? What would happen if we just assume it's not true? And so what they did is they assumed it's false. And if it's false, it ended up you can make it false in two different ways. So how do we make it false? So here's the actual fifth postulate at the top. So the original statement we just had, given a line and a point not on the line, exactly one line parallel to the given line can be drawn through the point. So one option to falsify it would be to say, given a line and a point not on it, no lines parallel can be drawn. What if we assume that it's impossible to draw a parallel line? Does the world fall apart? Is it possible? I mean, what happens? The other option, the other option is, given a line and a point not on the line, what if we have multiple parallel lines? Can that happen? Does the world fall apart, or can we make it work? And what they found out is that you can actually make a cohesive system even if you assume the opposite of that postulate. So option one turns into something called elliptic geometry, and option two, which apparently I lost a bullet point on, so I'm gonna add a bullet point on there real quick. This turned into hyperbolic geometry. Now, what do those geometries look like? We're not familiar with them because they're not really taught in high schools. The best way to understand elliptic geometry is to put yourself on the surface of a sphere. We're familiar with a sphere. We live on planet Earth. It's somewhat spherical. It's not exactly spherical, but it's somewhat spherical. The nice thing about dynamic geometry environments, modern ones allow you to do different types of geometry. So here's our sphere. Let me get the whole sphere on there. Oops. So now the idea is if we draw a line, we get a line. Now, something to take note. With spherical geometry, lines are defined only as what are called great circles. Meaning they have to go around the widest part of the sphere. So if you want to think of this, you can think of this essentially as an equator. If you think about the equator line. So what you can't do, so here's a line we can do. What you can't do is you can't put a little circle around the top. You know, if you go up and sail around the North Pole, that wouldn't count as a line. So we're only doing great circles. And if you restrict yourself to only doing great circles, it's pretty clear that any two great circles are always going to intersect. So in this case, there's an intersection point on the front of the sphere, and then on the dotted line in the back, which may be hard to see, there's another intersection point in the back. And if we think about what that assumption was, the assumption said, given a line and any point not on it, exactly no line parallel can be drawn. And that's the idea here, is that you can't draw a parallel line. Two great circles are always going to intersect. And so that became a model of elliptic geometry. And in particular, it became a super important model of elliptic geometry because as humans made better ships and airplanes, and trains, all of a sudden the curvature of the Earth became important. When Euclid was around, you know, they could only travel 100 miles, 200 miles, and everything was, for the most part, fairly flat if you're only going 100 miles. But the minute you start going thousands of miles, curvature becomes important, which is the reason if you ever look at a map and an airplane route, and you're flying from here to there, you know, if you ever look at the plane, the little picture of shows your path, it's curvy, because when you try to make the shortest distance, it ends up being curvy. Same idea. Became important. Hyperbolic, that one we don't have as intuitive a model for. Elliptic's nice because we're somewhat familiar with how the Earth works. Hyperbolic, there's no good real, shouldn't say there's no, there's not a good physical model of it. But software has come to our rescue a little bit, and the way that hyperbolic's gonna work, my instructor, when I took this geometry class, Dr. Hogger, she liked to call it petri dish geometry. Because everything takes place within a circle, and so she referred to that as the petri dish. And the interesting thing that happens in hyperbolic geometry, our lines are curvy. And in order to break that postulate, let's say we have a point not on the line, we can draw lots of parallel lines through there. So notice here's three lines that don't intersect this curve on the left. So these three lines in the center are all considered parallel to this line on the left, because they don't intersect it. And our lines don't extend beyond the circle, they stay within the circle. And there are more complicated reasons we could go into about why the model works. But we end up with this model that has curvy lines. So we end up with three different types of geometry: Euclidean, elliptic, and hyperbolic, all dependent upon whether or not we believe that fifth postulate. And mathematicians eventually discovered that you can have consistent systems depending upon which option you want. And so if we go back to my question then, my question for my study was, do students think differently? Want to back up. Do students' reasoning strategies vary when they're using different systems? You know, we're familiar with Euclidean. We're not as familiar with hyperbolic and elliptic. So do their brains work a little bit differently when they're in those systems? And that's what I was trying to figure out. So, how did I design my study? So what I did for my study was I got four pairs of college mathematics students who may or may not have been Spring Arbor students a number of years ago, which are all graduated now, so I don't feel bad talking about it because none of them are here and none of you know them. But I'm not going to use names anyway. But four pairs of college mathematics students. Now, this was a practicum. It was a preparation for my dissertation, so four pairs was enough to satisfy the requirements. If ever, when I get to my dissertation, it's going to be a lot more than four. But for the moment, it was just four. The students had a previous knowledge of DGE. They'd taken a geometry class with me, so they'd used the software before. They had even used hyperbolic geometry before. We had done a lot of that in class. We did not do elliptic geometry. That essentially we had skipped over just for time's sake. So that one was completely unfamiliar to them. But hyperbolic, they'd had some experience with. And what I did was I gave them each a task for about an hour. It was a proof-based task. So it asked some questions and said, can you prove these things true or false? And as they work, I videotaped them. I also did screen capture to figure out what were they actually doing on the screen. And so I ended up with these wonderful little videos. Let me open that up. And so when I say screen capture, it was literally just a silent video of watching the mouse move back and forth across the screen. And so that was a Spring Arbor student moving their mouse 2 years ago, doing different things. It looks like they're constructing a square. I think they're about to put a line across the top. Maybe not. I don't know. Oh, come on, finish the square. Oh, there we go. Okay, we got the square. Okay, so they were constructing a square. So anyway, I had a bunch of hour-long videos of watching students do stuff. Additionally, I also collected any written work. because every once in a while, sometimes it's easier just to do things by hand than it is to do things on a computer. And so they had scratch work, and so I collected all that. So lots of different things for me to look at and spend my evenings staring at. Now, the tasks I gave them, two questions that I wanted them to try to figure out. I defined something called the Lambert quadrilateral. It's a quadrilateral ABCD with three right angles at A, B, and C. And so they first had to actually construct that in the software. And then in each of the three geometries, what must be true of the fourth angle? And they had to justify their reasoning. So I'm going to pause right there before I read the next bullet point. But think about that for just a second. If we have a shape, let's say we're in high school Euclidean geometry. Euclidean or high school geometry. If you know for sure that you have one right angle, two right angles, and three right angles, anybody want to take a guess what that angle is going to be? It's a right angle. Yay. Okay, it's a right angle. Now, what about the other types of geometries? So as long as we have this one open, what if we do the same thing here? So we get one line. And the software is nice because it will construct right angles for you. So here's another right angle. So there's our first right angle. It's weird because they're curvy, but if you hold a corner of a sheet of paper up to that, I guarantee you that's actually a right angle. So let's give ourselves a second right angle. So point, right angle. Let's give ourselves a third right angle. Oops. Okay, now, before I actually do the construction, you know, a line's going to be coming down here. Anybody want to take a guess if it's still going to make a right angle? I see a couple heads shaking no. What type of angle will it make then if it's not a right angle? It can either be smaller than a right angle or bigger than a right angle. So, interestingly, it's possible to not have a quadrilateral at all. Those lines didn't intersect. But if you move that point and actually make them intersect, now we get a quadrilateral. And we get an angle down there. What type of angle is that? It's obviously not 90. Acute. Good, we know the word's acute. Good job. Okay, it's an acute angle. So the question then is, why is that an acute angle? And that's what the students had to try to figure out is, one, figure out that the fourth angle in hyperbolic is acute, and then justify their reasoning, make a good argument why that happens to be true. You know, we can see that it's true, but if they tell me on an exam it's true because it looks like it's less than 90, that's not good enough. I mean, maybe your eyes are deceiving you. Dr. K.
What happens if you, change the scale on that?
Okay, so before I change the scale, I'm going to measure it first, okay? Just so we can have an actual numerical measurement for that. So I'm going to measure that angle. So right now it's 30, can you read that from back there?
31.
I think I might be able to make that bigger font. Oh, maybe not. Let's click on it and then go to font. There we go, okay, 31 degrees. So if we change the scale, so let's move some, oops. Now the issue is we have to keep our quadrilateral actually quadrilateral, can I make that bigger? So it's down to 11 degrees. You know, the issue is when you change the scale, you start losing the quadrilateral because of how the lines work. Now, there was a 7. Anybody want to take a guess what the minimum angle that could be is? Theoretically zero. You know, if you could get those two lines right at the edge right there exactly to line up, essentially you get a 0 degree angle. Now, the other end of the spectrum says, what if you make this smaller? Notice that angle keeps getting bigger. Anybody want to take a guess what the biggest that's going to be is?
90.
90. The idea being that we say it's locally Euclidean, that if you restrict yourself small enough, it kind of sort of acts like high school geometry. Question?
So would you still be considered a quadrilateral when you use curved lines?
Yes.
So is that like the different type of geometry that you're
doing? Yeah, so because we're in a different geometry, our lines are now all curvy. And in fact, it's impossible to draw a straight line in here.
So it has new rules
because we broke that fifth postulate. Yep. Just like if we were in spherical geometry, the lines are curved there as well. And so the rules in that geometry say they're also curvy. So in this one, it happened to be less than 90 for that angle. Anybody want to take a guess what it would be in spherical geometry? It'll be greater than 90, actually. So that's
a dull question.
It's a dull question. Okay. Trying to be witty.
Oh, burn!
Okay. So that was my first question. The second question then says, is it possible to construct a regular quadrilateral in each of the three geometries? Anybody remember what a regular polygon is or a regular quadrilateral? What does it mean when we say regular? So, for instance, if we had a regular hexagon, the term regular means all the same size. And when you do that, you end up also, well, actually, technically you don't, but we're going to make all the angles the same. So same side length and same angle measures. And so in this case, it says, can you construct a regular quadrilateral, quad meaning, of course, four, in each of the three geometries? So in high school geometry, can we construct a regular quadrilateral? And if so, what would it be called? It's a square. Yeah. Four equal sides, four equal angles, it's a square. The question then is, can we do that in the non-Euclidean geometries? Is it possible to construct a square if we're in a weird geometry? So in this case, notice, we made our three 90-degree angles, if you remember. We had a 90 here, a 90 here, 90 here, and then we have this weird fourth angle, in this case way over there. That's not 90. So does that imply we can't make a square or a regular quadrilateral? Or maybe it's just going to look differently. So, I mean, we could make it smaller and try to shrink it down. But if you try that method, the only way you're going to make it work is if those four points land on top of each other, and then you don't actually get a shape anymore because the four points land on top of each other. The key to making a regular quadrilateral, if you're in hyperbolic geometry, is to give up on the fact that they're 90-degree angles, which the students that were in the study had difficulty doing because they wanted those to be 90s, and they wanted four 90s. But what ends up happening is that they're not actually 90-degree angles. So let me go ahead and construct one real quick. Let me clear that out. We're going to make a circle, and then we're going to make a perpendicular. Get this line and that point. We're going to make a perp. Put points in those spots. Make another perp. Make another perp. Make one more perp. And then finally, one last perp. And the four points that define our regular quadrilateral actually end up being those four points, and let me shade it for you. Oops, not the line, the point. That ends up being a regular quadrilateral. Ooh, I got applause for that, wow. I can do this all day long if you keep applauding. All sorts of fun shapes. So if we measure, now the weird thing is, if we move that, it starts looking very not regular. Because it sure looks like that side on the left is a lot shorter than the side on the right. And we said they're supposed to be the same size. And part of that has to do with the rules of how the geometry works. If we actually measure the length The software, which understands the rules quite well, will actually tell us that those lengths are, in fact, the same length, 2.8. The weird thing about this geometry is that distance changes the further you are from the center. And so if you have a segment, for instance, so let's say I make that segment and I drag that segment towards the edge, it gets smaller. It's still considered the same length the entire time, but as we get near the edge, it gets smaller. Now, one way to think about that is if you think of like a sphere model, it's not actually a sphere, but if you think of a sphere model, as you move things to the edge of the sphere, they kind of get further away from you visually, and so they shrink that way. It's not exactly the same thing, but it's close to that idea. So that becomes a regular quadrilateral, which is just weird looking and does not look like a regular quadrilateral, but it is. And so they had to figure out, can they construct that? Oh, and we forgot to measure the angles. So let's measure an angle. Oops. Angle. Actually, I clicked those in the wrong order. Let me start with this one. Angle. 37, that's hard to see. But it's 37. So in this case, the angles of all the angles, if you measure them, will all be 37. But the interesting thing is that can change depending upon how big it is. Where's the point? I need point B. There we go. The smaller that shape is, the closer it is to 90, or the closer it is to a square. Whereas the bigger that shape is, the more unsquare-like it becomes, and the smaller that angle becomes. And eventually, if you make it so that it's as big as possible, the angles then approach zero. Again, they're all the same. It's just regular quadrilaterals can be different if you're in hyperbolic or if you're in elliptic geometry. So those are my questions. And I gave him an hour to work on answering those questions, and we had varying degrees of success in that hour. In terms of analyzing it, one of the things I got to go through and do is, first I had to transcribe all of that video. So I had 4 hours of video, and I just sat there and typed out everything that was said. And so that was fun. And then going through there, I had to decompose all of that into what I called arguments. And any time they made a statement with a reasoning behind it, I think this is true because such and such, I would call an argument. And so I had to grab out all the different arguments that the students were making throughout that video. And then I analyzed it using something called Toulmin's model of argumentation, which you may or may not be familiar with. Probably not. Dating back to the 1950s, a guy named Toulmin said all arguments basically have this form. There are facts and there are conclusions are the two basic things you have to have. So in this case, the fact in this particular argument, Rick has fair skin, red hair, and freckles, and he sunbathed all day. And so somebody makes a conclusion and says, I think Rick's going to get sunburnt, which seems like a valid conclusion to make. And then you have something called a warrant. And in this case, the warrant, it's essentially the rationale, the reasoning for why we're jumping from the fact to the conclusion. And the reason we're going to make that conclusion is because people with fair skin, red hair, and freckles tend to get sunburnt. You know, we've been alive long enough, we have some experience to know that generally happens. All of my freckled friends get sunburnt easily. And so I have a reason for that conclusion. And then, of course, the warrant also has a reason. Well, how do I know that's true? Is there anything to back up my warrant? And so there's something called backing. And here we get a little bit of science.
Chemistry.
Thank you. People with fair skin, red hair, and freckles have more melanin in their skin, less melanin in their skin. And because they have less melanin, they get sunburnt more easily. And then, of course, you can have a rebuttal. Somebody can come along and say, yeah, but. And in this case, the yeah, but is, but Rick's parents both have fair skin, red hair, and freckles. They don't get sunburnt. And so what I did was I took all of the arguments that I saw those students making and I tried to diagram them all out. And then the interesting thing about the argument is, or the diagram is, they can get quite complicated because sometimes the warrant has a rebuttal, or sometimes there's a rebuttal of the rebuttal and they start growing quite large. And then as I diagrammed them, I tried to identify strategies that led specifically to the warrant and the rebuttals were what I was interested in. And then I tried to categorize them. Generally, there were two different broad types of strategies, column headers, what are called proactive and reactive strategies. Are students doing things with the software where they think they know what's going to happen after they do it? Or are they doing things with the software in hopes that maybe something will pop out that's interesting that I can use? So they can either use it proactively or reactive. And so some different things that students were actually doing with the software. Proactive, they were making constructions. Reactive, for instance, this visual confirmation. Students would sometimes say, I think such and such is true because it looks like it's true. You know, not because they have any good rationale, but because it looks like it. And so I called it visual confirmation, which is not the best way to argue something. Just because something looks like it's true is not necessarily true. Other times they would actually take a measurement because the software measures things. We saw that it measures things. That's at least a step in the right direction. Other things that students would do, dragging in order to show examples. You know, one of the nice things about the software is that it lets us drag. You know, we have this regular quadrilateral. You know, it looks, well, sort of looks regular now. But we can drag that and say, look, it doesn't matter where it is. It's still the same sizes. Everything stays the same. And theoretically, what we're doing when we're dragging is theoretically we're giving ourselves infinite examples of why something's true. Because every time it moves just slightly, we have a new example. And so dragging became super important. Looking at contradictions, looking for things that were invalid, things that didn't work. So different strategies, and I got to write up things about each of those things that were going on. Categorizing them into proactive and reactive strategies. These are my different pairs of students, S and J, F and P, B and L, H and A. Those all stand for something like the S and J. One student happened to be a senior, one student happened to be a junior. So S and J made sense. B and L, I think B, somebody had a blue shirt on, and L, I don't remember what the L stood for. But when you do research on people, you're not allowed to use names, and so you have to give them nicknames, and I just used letters because letters were convenient. Other people just make up names. I thought about trying to name them after Lord of the Rings characters, but my advisor said no. She said, you can't do that in a serious scholarly publication. So we used letters. So some different strategies. Something worth noting, the most interesting thing worth noting, was in Euclidean, there were hardly any reactive strategies. So if you look at that row, there's a bunch of no X's under Euclidean reactive, because in Euclidean, the students seemed to know what they were doing because they had so much experience with it. And so nothing surprised them in Euclidean. Everything they did, they kind of already knew what the outcome was going to be. Where in hyperbolic and elliptic, they were surprised a lot more. Some successes. With the first question, we had most successes. Just about everybody had deductive arguments in all three geometries. Except for H and A didn't particularly, yeah. They started with an inductive argument over in that right-hand column. They had one deductive argument that was wrong. When we moved to the second question, which was a much more difficult question, not a lot of people got it right. You can see in the second one, you know, people are arguing visual and visual. Well, it's true because it looks like it's true, which isn't that good of an argument. Other people tried to do deductive arguments, but they were wrong. Some other people tried to argue by construction. Well, the construction tells us it has to be true, but again, they were wrong. So not a lot of success with the second questions, which was unfortunate. Some themes that came out related to the questions. Measuring and dragging were both super important, and construction as well. They would argue by construction. But they were useful in doing both proactive and reactive strategies, which especially the dragging I thought was interesting being used as a proactive strategy. I assumed that was going to be more reactive, that they were going to use it and things were just going to pop out at them. Rebuttals, if there was ever a rebuttal, those came from reactive strategies. And a lot of times that rebuttal came from the software. The software said, oh, no, what you're trying to do isn't working. And that was reactive because they weren't expecting the rebuttals. And so by nature of that, they became reactive strategies. Deductive arguments, least common in Euclidean geometry, most common in non-Euclidean geometry. That one was surprising to me because I would have thought in Euclidean geometry, the one that they were most familiar with, they would have been able to make a deductive argument a lot more clearly than they would in the one they're not familiar with. But my assumption with that is that in Euclidean, I think because of their familiarity, I don't think they felt the need to make a deductive argument. They just kind of said, well, of course it's true. Everybody knows it's true, so why bother going through the process of making a deductive argument? Where I think when we moved to the non-Euclidean argument, then they actually felt pressure to actually justify what they were doing. And then, as I was expecting, reactive strategies occurred most common in the non-Euclidean geometry. In other words, they were surprised more by what they were doing because they're not as familiar with it. Where when they're in Euclidean geometry, the reactive strategies were least common. So some things to keep in mind with the study that I worked on is I only had four pairs of students, which is not a lot to try to make broad generalizations from. It's not a lot of data to look at. So for a dissertation, at some point, I may end up doing something similar, but with a lot more students. And because I had a small sample size, there were relatively few arguments that actually were made. So I had four pairs of students that each worked for about an hour, which is 4 hours. And the number of arguments I got was about 33 arguments, which isn't a ton of arguments to try to draw conclusions from. And so again, if I do it, again, hopefully I can get more arguments out of the students. One thing to keep in mind, and one reason this is a practicum and not a dissertation, is the questions I used ended up not necessarily being the best questions in the world. Especially the second question didn't necessarily elicit productive discourse. The second question ended up being hard enough that they just got stumped, and there was one team in particular that just sat there and kind of stared at their computer for 20 minutes. And I'm sure they were thinking things, but I have no idea what they were thinking because they were just staring at their computers. And so I need better questions that get them talking back and forth to each other. Some further questions going forward that may lead to a dissertation. The various ways students use the measurement tool. In watching the students, they measured everything they possibly could. Even if they were making a square in Euclidean geometry, after they made the square and declared it's a square, they still measured to make sure it was 90 degree angles. It's like, but why? They clicked the construct a perpendicular button, and they still measured to make sure it was a 90 degree angle. And it's like, but you know it's a 90 degree angle. And so there's some sort of comfort level that they have from the software that just reassures them and makes them feel better. And then the difference in reasoning strategies for those who have access to the software and those that just have paper and pencil. Because not every school has dynamic geometry environments, so what happens if you don't? How does life work? Anyway, that was my study. I may turn it into something bigger when I get to the dissertation. People that helped me that deserve thanks. Bryn Keller at the top is my current advisor. She was the one that probably gave me the most feedback on my final drafts. AJ Edson was another person on my committee that got to approve whether or not I passed. Aaron Stair provided feedback and just a lot of encouragement. She is actually another student. So as Michigan State with the practicum, you need two faculty members and a student to serve on your committee. And the student sometimes is useful because they can tell you things that the instructors are looking for that the instructors don't necessarily tell you about. And so they can give you some inside information. Unfortunately, they don't get voting privileges, though. So the ultimate decision comes down to the actual faculty members. But a lot of support from Aaron. Michael Weiss and Sharon Sank were involved initially in the setup and some of the ideas for the project. Of course, my wife and kids, who are willing to cook me dinner and bring me dinner downstairs while I'm staring at videos and not bug me. And then also the math faculty at SAU who bend over backwards to help me with my grad school program. So, anyway, questions about anything? Yes?
I'm not a math person, so I don't know. But are there any other possible geometry worlds out there besides the three they
There are, but they just get more and more complicated. So if you want to learn more, Google non-Euclidean geometries, and you'll get all sorts of different types of geometries out there. One of them that I like playing with is something called fractal geometry. And fractal geometry is fun because you get some of the world's best looking art. You know, this is not something that you can make easily with a straight edge and a compass. And so the question is, how do you make stuff like this? That's a fairly newer type of geometry, and when I say newer, like since 1960s, because you essentially have to have a computer in order to be able to do this geometry. But if you're interested in geometry, we offer a course called Math 421, Modern Geometry, where we get to look at lots of non-Euclidean geometries. Just throwing a plug out there for it.
Are they still finding more, or creating?
That is what mathematicians do. They say, what if? And so yes, are they still finding more? And then, yeah, they have to go through a bunch of steps to prove it and then get other people to read their stuff and say, yeah, that makes sense, I agree with that. And there's like a whole vetting process. That's what math researchers do. They look for new and interesting things to explore. And sometimes there's not always necessarily a reason for doing it, but we do it because it's fun. And then we realize later, oh, there is a reason for doing this. You know, like the non-Euclidean geometries. You know, you can study elliptical geometry and then all of a sudden realize, wait a minute, our Earth is a sphere. There is a purpose for this. As compared to the hyperbolic geometry where you say, I don't actually know what that's used for yet. So, all right. So yeah, they're still coming up with new stuff.